My friends, welcome to the Word Exposed. Join me in contemplating the Lord present in the Holy Scriptures today, the 17th Sunday in Ordinary Time. In today's Gospel, Jesus continues to speak about the Kingdom of God. In the first two parables, He says that if our pursuit of God's Kingdom is our primary goal, we will direct everything else toward it. One sold everything he had, in the first parable, to buy the field where he had found the buried treasure. And in the second parable, the merchant sold everything to buy the pearl of great value. The third parable, meantime, reminds us of the gospel proclaimed last week. On Judgment Day, the wicked are to be separated from the righteous. Let us set our values and priorities right.
A reading from the first book of Kings. The Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream at night. God said, "Ask something of me, and I will give it to you." Solomon answered, "O Lord, my God, you have made me your servant, king to succeed my father David. But I am a mere youth, not knowing at all how to act. I serve you in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a people so vast that it cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding heart to judge your people and to distinguish right from wrong. For who is able to govern this vast people of yours?" The Lord was pleased that Solomon made this request. So God said to him, "Because you have asked for this, not for a long life for yourself, not for riches, nor for the life of your enemies, but for understanding, so that you may know what is right, I do as you requested. I give you a heart so wise and understanding that there has never been anyone like you up to now. And after you, there will come no one to equal you." The Word of the Lord.
Hi, I'm Haley. If someone told you, "I'll give you anything you want," what would you ask for? In today's Bible story, God told King Solomon he would give him anything he asked for. What do you think King Solomon wanted? Let's find out.
David was old. He had been king over Israel for a long time, and now his son Solomon had become king. God had promised David that Israel's king would always be someone from his family. Because David was at the end of his life, he gave Solomon some instructions.
"Be strong and brave, Solomon," David said. "Obey God and you will be successful. God will keep his promise that every king of Israel will come from our family."
David died, and Solomon took control of his father's kingdom. Solomon married the daughter of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. With the princess as his wife, Solomon didn't have to worry about being attacked by the Egyptians. The two countries were at peace.
One night, God appeared to Solomon in a dream. God said, "Solomon, ask for anything you want, and I will give it to you. Anything. A king might have asked to live a long life or to have lots of riches. Solomon could have asked God to give him victory over all his enemies. But Solomon didn't ask to be rich or to live a long life. Solomon wanted to be a good king. He asked for something even better.
God, you made me king after my father, Solomon said. I am young and I don't know very much about being king. Please make me wise and obedient to you. Help me know the difference between right and wrong. Help me lead your people well.
God answered Solomon, I am pleased you have asked for this. I will give you wisdom. In fact, I will make you more wise and understanding than anyone who's ever lived. No one in the future will be as wise as Solomon.
But God wasn't finished. Because you asked for wisdom, I will also give you what you did not ask for. Long life, riches, and honor. You'll be greater than any other king during your lifetime. Solomon woke up and realized God had spoken to him in a dream. Solomon praised God and offered sacrifices to worship him.
King Solomon could have asked for earthly treasures, but he asked for wisdom to lead God's people. God created people to do his will. Jesus provided the ultimate example by completely trusting God with his life. Jesus surrendered his own life to die on the cross for our sins so that God could bring us back to himself. Wisdom, I would have never guessed, but that's such a wise thing to ask for. Solomon didn't want what was best for him. He wanted what was best for God's people. And God was happy with Solomon's choice. God blessed Solomon and gave him even more than he asked for.
Your Majesty, your top advisor requests permission to speak to you.
So granted.
You may enter.
Long live King Solomon.
Rise, top advisor.
Thank you, my lord. My lord, I wish to tell you that I think it's a very wise choice that you have chosen Benaiah to be over the entire army.
Benaiah has been very faithful to me, my top advisor. But as far as my wisdom, you should know that I certainly could not have come with that on my own.
My king, whatever do you mean?
The Lord God, top advisor. For God came to me in a dream and said, ask, what shall I give you? And I said to him, I am but a child, knowing not whether to come in or go out. Therefore I asked our God for wisdom, so that I might correctly judge his people. Therefore God has indeed honored his promise to me.
I see, my king.
Wait for me! Give me back my baby! My baby!
Scratch!
I tried to stop them. They pushed by me. I couldn't stop them.
Your Majesty! This is my child.
She's lying.
Trying to take him from me.
She's lying. This is my baby.
Quiet.
Give me back
Silence.
My baby.
Take the baby. Speak.
Well, Your Majesty, this woman and I live in the same house. Not too long ago, I had a son. 3 days later, she had a son. And one night, while she was sleeping, she rolled over her baby.
Don't believe her. She's lying.
This is my child. Anyway, then, in the middle of the night, while I was sleeping, she took her dead son.
You're lying. This is my baby.
Child.
You're lying.
Stop it already.
You're lying.
Enough. God, bring me a sword.
King.
I want you to cut this baby.
No, no,
half.
Not my baby!
Give
no.
half to one woman,
no,
and
please,
the other
no.
half to the other woman.
Give him to her, don't
cut my baby!
Don't we
no.
get a part of the child?
No, please, give him to her, don't cut my child.
This is the true mother of the child. Return the living baby to her.
That's not fair! Your Majesty, that's not fair!
Woman,
child.
You will leave my presence and my throne room while you still have a life. Immediately. Now! Now!
No! Oh, my precious Mary. Oh, thank you, Your Majesty. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
May the God of Israel go with you, my child.
Giving you the wisdom.
God bless you, my child.
Thank you so much.
King, oh, my King, I can see now that the God of heaven has truly blessed you with wisdom.
Is to me more precious than thousands of gold and silver pieces. Lord, I love your commands. Let your kindness comfort me according to your promise to your servant. Let your compassion come to me that I may live, for your law is my delight. Lord, I love your commands, for I love your commands more than gold, however fine. For in all your precepts I go forward, every false way I hate. Lord, I love your commands. Wonderful are your decrees, therefore I observe them. The revelation of your words sheds light, giving understanding to the simple. Lord, I love your commands.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, we know that all things work for good for those who love God, who are called according to His purpose. For those He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, so that He might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those He predestined, He also called. And those He called, He also justified. And those He justified, He also glorified. The Word of the Lord.
The Future Glory. Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory He will reveal to us later. For all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who His children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse. but with eager hope, the creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. For we know that all creation has been groaning, as in the pains of childbirth, right up to the present time. And we believers also groan, even though we have the Holy Spirit within us as a foretaste of future glory, for we long for our bodies to be released from sin and suffering. We too wait with eager hope for the day when God will give us our full rights as His adopted children, including the new bodies He has promised us. We were given this hope when we were saved. If we already have something, we don't need to hope for it. But if we look forward to something we don't yet have, we must wait patiently and confidently. And the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for. But the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father, who knows all hearts, knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. For God knew His people in advance, and He chose them to become like His Son, so that His Son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, He called them to come to Him. And having called them, He gave them right standing with Himself. And having given them right standing, He gave them His glory.
Romans 8 and 28 says, "And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God." No matter what you're going through, you gotta know it's gonna work out for your good.
Sometimes life gets hard and you don't know why. Things just don't get better, yeah. But then a still small voice tells you to hold on, cause it's gonna get better.
Look at these bills. Look at this. Look at this.
I see it. The bills just crashed.
We're gonna pray. Look at that account.
I see it. The requirements of the job.
Wish I could help you. How are you? How are you?
No, you don't have no room.
Don't have any room.
Did you see my resume?
I got to do something for you. We know that all
things work together for our good.
Nothing
that we can do shall be wasted.
God has a plan. At times, we don't know what it is. That's when we should seek His face. Acknowledge Him during what you're going through. And it shall direct your path.
Situations are there because He knows that you can take it to become something
better. And
when all that all things work together for our good,
work together.
Nothing that we've been through shall be
nothing
wasted.
Shall be wasted
and we know
on
that
you.
All things work together
oh, no,
for our
no,
good.
No, no, no,
nothing
no.
That we've been through shall be wasted.
Every trial, situation. All things, they work together, yeah.
We know that all things
work together for good to them that love the Lord.
We know that all things
that are called according to His purpose,
we know
His plan. To them who love the Lord, yeah.
All things work together for good to them who love the Lord. Whoa.
things work together for good to them who love the Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure buried in a field, which a person finds and hides again, and out of joy goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant searching for fine pearls. When he finds a pearl of great price, he goes and sells all that he has and buys it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net thrown into the sea, which collects fish of every kind. When it is full, they haul it ashore and sit down to put what is good into buckets. What is bad, they throw away. Thus it will be at the end of the age. The angels will go out and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace, where there will be wailing and grinding of teeth. Do you understand all these things?" They answered, "Yes." And he replied, "Then every scribe who has been instructed in the kingdom of heaven is like the head of a household who brings from his storeroom both the new and the old." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
If you knew about a fortune in treasure buried in the backyard of a house that was for sale, wouldn't you buy that house as quick as you could? Would you haggle over the price? I know I wouldn't. In the parables of the hidden treasure and the priceless pearl, Jesus makes it clear that if we give up everything we have in order to gain his kingdom, it's a really good trade. Let's read from Matthew chapter 13, starting at verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, He went away and sold everything he had and bought it.
The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore, and they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things?
Jesus asked.
Yes.
They replied. He said to them,
therefore, every teacher of the law who has been instructed about the kingdom of heaven is like the owner of a house who brings out of his storeroom new treasures as well as old.
Our gospel passage for this Sunday is taken from St. Matthew. We have been reflecting on discovering God's treasure for all of us. King Solomon was given a treasure, the treasure which is to be king over God's people. And he discovered it. I will serve you, God, in the midst of your people, the people that you have chosen. And for that treasure, Solomon asked God for a gift, for a value, a primary value, so that he could fulfill his mission. And that was wisdom, an understanding heart, discernment. And God was so pleased that Solomon was able to let go of other things that a king deserves: a long life, riches, and triumph over enemies. Solomon is a good example of a wise person, of a discerning person. You know your treasure, and it becomes your primary value. In the second reading, St. Paul reminds the Romans that we have a treasure given by God. And what is it? It is our calling, our predestination to share in the image of Jesus, his Son. What a treasure. And we should live it out in our respective callings or vocations in life. And we know Jesus. He was so focused on his mission that he was willing to be poor, to be stripped of his prerogatives, to empty himself for the treasure, which is the fulfillment of God's will, the fulfillment of his mission. We are asked to share in that image. In the gospel, we have some parables again about the kingdom of God and how we could discover God's treasure for us. In the first parable, you have this buried treasure. You know, sometimes the gift of God to us, our mission, our calling, is buried. it's not quite obvious. You don't see it all the time. In the first parable, the person surprisingly hit on it. Sometimes we need to be surprised. We need to be attentive. The treasure that is not so obvious to us might be right there, you know? And if we are not attentive, we might not see it as a treasure. And the man was so happy that he hid it again, sold everything that he had to buy the whole land. If he owns the whole land, then he owns also the treasure that is found or buried in that land. The second parable, now it is not now by accident or as it were by surprise. The merchant was seeking a valuable pearl and he finds it. So, wow, the kingdom of God also involves search. Once in a while, you bump on it. But we are also asked to search for it. And when you have found the valuable pearl, then again with joy, be able to sell everything that you have in order to possess that most valuable pearl. Very often, we look at, oh, what will I miss if I sell everything? Oh, wow. How difficult to part from all of these things that I have earned, that I enjoy, now I possess. You know, the perspective must change. It is not about parting from things that are important. It is about finding the treasure. If we change our perspective, then we know that if you have the most important treasure or pearl, then the other things, while important, become relative to the absolute importance of the treasure. Jesus is our treasure, as St. Paul tells us. To be like Jesus is our main treasure. And to own that treasure, other things will pale in comparison. So it is the joy of possessing Jesus, of being like Jesus, that will enable me to say, I am free to let go of the others. But in the end, you know, in the end, we need this to undergo this process. We need to search for the treasure. We need interior freedom. We need wisdom, like Solomon, to choose the main treasure. And God gives us that opportunity while we are alive here on earth. But in the end, no, just like the third parable, the wicked and the just will be separated from one another. We hope we would belong to the just, the wise, who have discovered a treasure and would not exchange the true treasure for fleeting pleasures and other things that we or the world presents as true treasures when in fact they are not. They are good, but they are not the absolute treasure that Jesus is. Tomorrow we celebrate the feast of Saint Ignatius of Loyola, the founder of the Society of Jesus, the man who by accident, literally an accident, you know, discovered the treasure that is his faith, the treasure that is Jesus. And when he found the treasure, he would not let go of it. He let go of other things, of a career, of military conquest. The treasure who is Jesus should not be let go of. You let go of others, but not Jesus. And the prayer that is associated with him, that is now known by everyone, even if they don't know that it came from Saint Ignatius, is about that. everything is your gift to me. Now I return them to you. Give me only your love. Your love. And everything I will forego. I have found the treasure, your love, and all other things I will forego. The word has been exposed. Let us now fulfill it.
During a sabbatical some years ago, I was fortunate to take a course on the parables from Dominican Sister Barbara Reed at the Catholic Theological Union in Chicago. In her course, Sister Barbara told us that parables can have different interpretations. You are on the right track, she said, if the interpretation matches the overall theme of the evangelist in his gospel and this is an important quote, if it is challenging to those in power and comforting to those who are afflicted. Her series of books entitled Parables for Preachers is a marvelous source, and I'd like to draw on her reflections for the three parables we hear today at Mass. Now, two of them have to do with discoveries. A man digs up a treasure in a field, and a merchant seeks and finds a valuable pearl. Sister Barbara suggests these are two ways we discover the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. One is by accident, the other by searching. Both characters illustrate the total response we must make to God. Now, Sister Barbara cautions that the kingdom is something that cannot be bought or possessed. It is rather God's gift, and the discovery brings us great joy. She also noted that the two individuals are not necessarily perfect. The man who digs up the treasure in someone else's field would have dubious rights to his find. He's on shaky moral ground. The pearl merchant could also be greedy and possessive, but he could be a redeemed rich man, honestly seeking the kingdom of heaven. Both characters, Sister Barbara suggests, might show up in today's third parable of the dragnet, gathering in the good and the bad. To make easy judgments on others, she notes, can, quote, bind us to the mix of both good and bad in persons and structures. The kingdom of heaven waits to welcome all those who seek it sincerely.
We heard the prayer of King Solomon earlier. Aware of his limitations, Solomon prayed for wisdom and an understanding heart so he could better govern God's people. The Lord granted him his prayer, and generations will remember Solomon as a wise king. Today, let us reflect on the content of our prayer. What do we pray for? Prayer, whether personal or communal, disposes us to communicate and to relate with God. Saint Teresa of Avila, known for her intense prayer life, says, "Prayer is a friendly conversation with the one whom we know loves us." This idea is likewise discernible in the gospel parable about a Pharisee and a tax collector who prayed at the same time in the temple. Unlike the Pharisee who positioned himself at the front and thanked God that he was not an evildoer like other people, the tax collector remained at a distant corner, mindful of his sins and nothingness before God. He uttered a prayer of remorse, but also of hope. "Lord, have mercy on me, for I am a sinner." His sinfulness did not inhibit him from coming to God because he knew God is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in loving kindness and truth. Friends, we can come to God in prayer because He loves us. And hopefully, we allow His merciful love to transform us into His ways. We do not pray to elevate ourselves before God while deriding others whom we consider as unworthy of facing God. We pray instead for God's mercy and the humility to accept a change of heart so that all of us may become like Christ. Saint Pio of Pietrelcina, an advocate of frequent prayer, says, "The best consolation is that which comes from prayer. We see it in Jesus Himself. Remember Him at Gethsemane and Golgotha? He sends with horror His impending death. In the garden, His agony began, but He prayed with docility and faith. He faced arrest, torture, and death with serenity. Your will be done. Forgive them, Father. I commit my spirit to your hands." How could this be possible? In prayer, Jesus affirmed His communion with God, which was stronger than fear. This enabled Him to become a channel of consolation to others too: the women of Jerusalem, the repentant thief, His mother and disciples, and all of us sinners. This is the same closeness of God felt by Christian martyrs across the generations. As we pray for relief from many forms of suffering afflicting us, we pray for the faith to see God's abiding closeness to us so that we may become channels of God's presence to others too. There you go, friends. Conversion and consolation, both gifts of prayer. How much we need these today. A person converted into the ways of God and consoled by Him does not pray for oneself only, but for others too. As we pray for a good life for ourselves, we pray for a good life for others too. And as we pray for the reformation of others, we pray for our reformation too. True communion with God in prayer impels us to be one with others, as Jesus has shown.
Early in the morning, talking it over, me and God. Late at night, talking it over, me and God. You could say we're like two peas in a pod, me and God. He's my Father, He's my friend, the beginning. And the rod, we're a team.